Hello everyone. In this video, I'm going to provide you with the explanation of the essay Freedom by George Bernard Shaw. George Bernard Shaw was an Irish playwright, a critic, political activist who contributed immensely to the world of literature with as many as 60 plays, satires, and historical allegories. He was awarded the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1925. He also founded the London School of Economics. This Freedom, it is one of the series of radio talks delivered in 1935 on the BBC. It was intended for larger listeners. And in this mass delivery, Shaw satirizes the contemporary social condition. He denounces the conventional and capitalistic view of freedom. He draws the attention to the unjust social structure which needs to be brought down through democratic means. Let's get started with the essay. You can read the lines of the essay for yourself and listen to the explanation. In these lines, the writer says that there is no such person who is absolutely free, who can do things that he likes or cannot do things that he dislikes. There is no such person because we have to do few things whether we like or not. For example, eating, sleeping, bathing, all these are compulsory actions for human beings. Half the day, we are slave to necessary things that we are bound to do, whether we are kings or common man. Wives of laborers are even worse because with all the other additional labor that they do, they have to do the work of children, giving birth and nurturing the children as well. In the given lines here, the writer says that the natural works like sleeping or eating cannot be left. These works also involve other works, like if you have to eat, you need to prepare food. If you have to sleep, you have to prepare beds and so on. If we have to walk on streets, we have to cover ourselves. Food, house, clothes can be produced by human labor. If they can be produced, then they can be stolen as well. The writer gives us examples that if you like honey, let the bees do the hard work to make them, and then you can simply steal and eat it. Another example that he gives is, if we can make a horse our slave, if we are lazy to walk from one place to another. What we can do to a bee or horse can be done to human beings as well. From horse and bee, he moves to social and political condition where a man, a woman, or a child can be forced to be a slave and work for many. This slavery can be achieved by force of fraud or trickery or by teaching them religiously that it is their duty to sacrifice their freedom for someone else. The writer is asking people to be careful of such practice because if they allow any person or class of person to have an upper hand, then they will shift their part of slavery to nature to the shoulder of the slaves. Which means the act of cooking, preparing food, will be shifted to such a weaker section of the society. If these people are not careful, then they will be made to work for 8 to 14 hours a day. But they will not be economically benefited. They will only earn the amount with which their families can be provided. And this minimum earning can be done in half the time they are working. So they should be careful, otherwise they will work more and earn less. The writer feels the duty of the government should be to prevent people from being imposed with extra work. But unfortunately, the government is doing just the opposite. They are enforcing slavery and calling it freedom. G.B. Shaw feels that government regulates or tries to keep slavery under check and also keep the greed of the masters within limit. They very smartly abolished chattel slavery when it was costlier than wage slavery. They give freedom to the slaves to choose their master, but they remain slaves whether they are in any system of slavery. This they call a great victory of freedom. When such slaves complain, they are given the right to vote and govern their country on their own. In the elections, the underprivileged choose between two candidates, and these two candidates are rich and similar to each other. Voting for either doesn't help the slaves as their working hours are not reduced. The newspapers declared that the vote of the slaves have decided the election. They are free citizens in a democratic country. And the slaves do believe these declarations innocently. In these lines, the writer talks about slavery of man to nature. He goes on to say that nature is kind to her slaves. Nature has made few activities compulsory, like eating and drinking. And though these activities are compulsory, they are pleasurable. Nature has made all these compulsory activities pleasurable, something that we want more and more. The writer now talks about slavery of man to man, which is hateful and is opposite of slavery of man to nature. It is hateful to both body and spirit. No poet ever has praised slavery of one man to another. Karl Marx and Thomas More both denounced slavery and tried to abolish it. Marx, he says that it's extremely cruel to make one man slave of another man. These slaves should be abolished. Man should do his own work using his hands and brain rather than forcing anyone else. If you don't stop slavery, then there will be a civil war, a class war between master and slaves. Parliament, schools and newspapers are used by master class to create a sense of false comfort in the minds of those without power. They can't realize their slavery. And this is taught from the very childhood. School children are taught about England as the land of the free and the chain of historical accomplishments prove it. The freedom that was earned by the ancestors by forcing King John to sign the Magna Carta after defeating the Spanish Armada and when King William had to give assent to the Bill of Rights or the American Declaration of Independence was made, or when the battles of Waterloo and Trafalgar were won. How the Germans, Austrians, Russian, and Ottoman empires were changed into republics. On the contrary, when the ordinary people demonstrate, they are held responsible because of the vote they gave. When these slaves grumble or complain, they are held responsible for their own condition as they couldn't use their vote well. They're reminded of all the benefits they are getting, like the factory acts, the wages boards, free education. The justification is made by telling the poor that the rich are taxed almost half of their incomes, even though it is the poor who pay almost half their pay as rent and work double the amount each day. So this shows the amount of exploitation that the slaves go through. They work harder, but at the end of the day, they earn less, have less benefits and luxury for themselves than the master class. In these lines, Shaw says that whenever famous writers like Voltaire, Rousseau, Shelley, Karl Marx, and others write and protest against such practices, then they are termed as antisocial and their works become inaccessible. It becomes a criminal act to buy or sell their books. So, directly or indirectly, England tries to curb the people who speaks against their laws and policies. If the followers of such writers revolt, England declares a war against them, lends money to other powers, and force these revolutionists to restore slavery. So by the use of power and money, England has been enforcing slavery for generations. When England won at Waterloo, it advertised its victory, and the innocent slaves cheered for England's victory in restoring slavery. These slaves are so innocent that they do not even understand that how their lives are at stake when they allow England to win against them. At first, the revolution in Russia in 1922 was criticized and ridiculed. But when the revolution turned into a powerful military, England took a U-turn and shook hands with its enemies and invited them to the state dinner. The poor and the underprivileged are brainwashed to believe the inferiority and submit to their masters. Not only slaves have false beliefs, but the master class also lives in a delusion. When children of master class go to elite schools and colleges, university, they get all the privileges. They get conditioned to believe that they are superior because of the privileges that they get. This feeling of superiority makes them insensitive to the plight and sorrow of the underprivileged, who have never had access to the privilege like them. The educated master class considers themselves superior to the common worker who is doing his work, earning his livelihood for him, and if demand arises, even sheds his blood for his master. This unjust is slowly accepted in the system. The underprivileged don't accept this difference or discrimination quietly. But if they rebel, they will be punished. The writer says that some corrupt officer will come to fight for the underprivileged, and these underprivileged will cheer for the leader. They're not aware of the motives of the officer. The underprivileged plead against their master, but instead of that, they should use their power of vote to stand against this unjust system. So Shaw feels that this power to vote is a very vital thing, because this is the only thing through which the slave class can move out of its slavery. they can create their own system which treats them just and equal to the master class. The writer states that he, until now, he has only shared facts with us. He doesn't want to draw any conclusion, as that would lead to some sort of controversy. He goes on to say that whenever he speaks over the radio, he tries to keep away from being controversial. He even doesn't ask people to draw any conclusion, as they may come to some dangerous conclusion for themselves. In these lines, the writer feels that no one wants to be called a slave, but slavery is not that bad. Aristotle had a view that law and order and government would not function well if the people are not superior in the look, dress, lifestyle, etc. Through the superiority of all these, they command control over others. They attain the superiority of looks and lifestyle because of many slaves working for them. They attain this godlike image by creating a nation of slaves and proving themselves to be superior than their servants. The underprivileged are so persuaded by the class setup that they vote against themselves, common workers. When women who are underprivileged misused their power of vote by voting women who were fighting for their cause. So people don't realize the power of vote that they have. Instead of voting against people of their class, they should vote against people of the master class, so that their candidates of their own class, can stand and fight for their rights. The author feels that nature is easiest to be changed if changed from young age. But this class system is so deep-rooted that even infants know it before leaving their cradle. This difference between slave and master is an artificial discrimination that education has created and which shadows the life of a person since infancy. This difference can be bridged if education is changed and if prejudices are stopped. So in order to bring the equality between slave and master class, we need to change the system of education. Shaw is asking for a fair distribution of production that is done every day. There has been an advancement in scientific and technology, and now we produce much more than we did earlier. The writer reflects on the fact that though we can now cultivate the sky as well as the earth by drawing nitrogen from it to increase the quality of grass, to enhance the quality of food given to the cattle, and consequently improve our cattle, butter, and poultry, but it is risky as well, as they are no more nutritious like earlier. Shaw comments on the ecological disturbance, which is the harsh reality of the modern world. And this harsh reality can only be checked by nature, and which nature tries to do time to time in order to check the greed of human beings. The writer feels man should give up the dream to be free, as 12 hours we have to do slavery to natural demands, and remaining 12 hours also we need to do things to earn a living or let anyone else earn for us. In a civilized and progressive country, freedom is restricted by law of the land, enforced by the police. If we don't obey, we will be punished and even imprisoned. If law is practiced well, then we don't need to complain, as a freedom is increased by saving us from crime and disorder. In the present unfair and unjust social order, the underprivileged are imposed with the rules of the landlord or employer. The slave class are dominated by their master in every field of their life. The only remedy is to join trade union movement. But the problem with trade union is the practice of strikes, which Shaw feels is madness. Because if strikes happen at such a rate, then human race will finish in a week. The workers will be the first to die. Hence, trade unions should never do more than one big strike at a time. In these lines, Shaw says that after working for hours, we can enjoy some time in reading, watching movies or football match, but if we have worked hard and we are tired, then we won't enjoy our free time as well. In these lines, Shaw feels that it's important to save money. He feels England cannot understand the meaning of freedom because they have never had any. They should call freedom as leisure, because if they call it leisure, then they will want more leisure and hence earn more money to enjoy their leisure time. He is also asking people not to vote for any candidate who claims to fight for the freedom, because in reality he is not going to do so. Here, the writer says that if we get more leisure and more money than we are used to, then we do not know what to do with it because we are not used to getting more in our lives. Shaw ends the essay with a thought-provoking question. If we get unlimited freedom, will we be able to handle it? He also wants common man to make a decision as to how they want to end their work life. Work 8 hours and return with a full pension, or work 4 hours till they turn 70. We will now do the second part, which is Understanding Freedom and Discipline by Jay Krishnamurti. The thoughts and ideas of Jay Krishnamurti about freedom are quite similar to the ones we discussed by G.B. Shaw. He also feels that freedom is not possible until unless we are enlightened. Let's see the essay in details. People think that through some sort of discipline we can attain freedom, which is not true. Because in discipline, we build a barrier against something that is wrong. Discipline can't be considered a way to freedom. Instead, discipline curtails freedom. When we try to discipline ourselves, we try to stop ourselves from going beyond a limit. And that is not freedom. Freedom doesn't have any sort of barrier or limitation. Freedom can't exist within a frame, within limitations. Hence, we can't attain freedom as we live with boundaries of moral values, traditions, religious beliefs, etc. A man can't be free if he is living in a limited world, if he is enclosed by boundaries. In order to attain freedom, we have to break these walls of tradition and think for ourselves, rather than blindly following someone else, however great that person may be, or however happy we may seem to be. When we accept these traditions, we stop doing anything new. Hence, we are not free and not happy. Our elders have asked us to be disciplined. We impose it on ourselves or others do. By freedom to think or inquire, we discover ourselves, our own potential. The search of truth is difficult. It needs alertness and constant inquiry, which we lack. The writer feels that if we are constantly told what is wrong and right, we lose our perception and intelligence to differentiate. If we blindly follow tradition, then we will be like fools, lacking intelligence. Intelligence happens when we think, discover, and search. Minds become alert and active and clear. We turn to be fully integrated individual and not a frightened one. Intelligence requires that you break away from tradition, stop blindly following it, and rather question. There is a constant conflict in us due to the conflicting thoughts of parents or society and us. There is a conflict between others and us. And if we don't settle this conflict, then we will suffer pain throughout our life. We will always feel like doing something but not being able to do so. In these lines, the writer says that freedom and discipline are contradictory, just the opposite. At a young age, we should find out what we want to do with our lives. If we don't, we will never be happy as an individual. The writer goes on to tell us that when we pass villagers on the road, we never pay attention to their miserable condition. We are so preoccupied in our own lives that we turn insensitive to them. This is because of centuries of tradition that has made us so unconcerned about things around us, about people and their suffering, their miseries. We almost turn a blind eye towards them. We constantly go through the fear of others and their perception. What will they say? What will they think about me? Is a constant question that we have in our minds. And because of this fear of being judged by others, we forget to show sympathy, affection, and care for the underprivileged. We become too insensitive. And sensitivity is destroyed by discipline, by fearing others, and by being too self-absorbed. To be really free is to be sensitive. When you can care for someone, when you can think, when you can sympathize for someone without a mental barrier, without a sense of fear, that is true freedom. It's important to start thinking, because through thinking or intelligence, we can solve the problems of our life, the problems of others, and the problems of our society, and hence build a better country. Thank you for staying connected. I hope I've been able to help you out with this essay.